Hello and welcome to Devlog number one of my second, so far unnamed, game. My name is Auro and I will be your host for this Devlog. Well, most likely for all of the Devlogs. In the previous Devlog, a prologue Devlog, if you will, I got all the preparation tasks ready to start actually working on the game in Unity. In this Devlog, I will be building the foundations for the core game mechanics. But just quickly before we get into it, a quick disclaimer that I am not a coding guru. In these devlogs, I will present problems that I faced and how I solved them. When I do this, know that aside from whatever solution I came up with, there probably exists a more optimal solution also. I am just trying to get things done and move on. Okay, good. With that out of the way, let's get into it. To make progress with any big task like making a game, you need to chop it into small pieces and work on those small pieces one by one. To start with something, I wanted to first be able to drag blocks that I create with code. This was quite easy once I remembered that I needed to change the mouse coordinates into world coordinates used within the game. I am just updating the position of the block while dragging it. Next, I wanted to add some placement rules for the blocks. I want them to snap to each other. Each block will have doorways, so I also want the doorways to face each other when they snap. I also want to make sure the blocks won't overlap when I place them. Okay, that's already three things. Let's go one by one. Making sure the blocks don't overlap I can do easily by having a collider on both blocks and checking that they are not touching. For now, I just set a log message to let me know if they are touching. I wanted to add the doorways and set up a check to see if they are near another block. I had never really used raycasts in Unity before, so I decided I would give that a try. I set it up to draw debugging lines so I can see where the raycast is going. Now my room can shoot lasers. Awesome. In Mortal Glory, I had a similar need to detect nearby units, and in it, I did it just by checking the nearby coordinates. It could have been a viable solution for this problem also, but I thought raycasting might be a bit more flexible solution. Plus, lasers are much cooler than just checking coordinates. Here I am demonstrating that it's detecting the nearby rooms properly. Next I wanted to have the blocks snap to a grid. I figured the simple solution is for me to just round the coordinates when I place the block. This worked well until I tried it with different sized blocks. The problem is that it's snapping the blocks by the pivot point, which is in the middle of the block. It works well with blocks that consists of odd number of squares, like 1x1 block, but a block with an even number of squares in height or width, the pivot point will not match with the grid. My first lazy idea was just to make the grid smaller. But even if visually it looked a bit more pleasant, I quickly realized that this was just like putting a bow on my problem and making the problem just look a bit better visually than actually solving it. Well, the simple solution for this was just to put each block under a parent object and change the position of the block so that the parent object matches with the grid. After that, when I snap them to grid, they fit nicely. Next, I wanted to give the blocks the ability to detect if there's another block touching them. I figured a good way to do this would be to give them two additional box colliders to feel around for neighbors. Why two box colliders, you might ask? Well, I want to check if a block is touching on the sides, but if only the corners are touching, I won't count that as a touch. While testing this, I noticed that the game wasn't always detecting my clicks properly. I found out that the reason was likely the new colliders I added to the blocks. The onMouseDown method was stopping at the first collider it detected. So, the game randomly not detecting clicks was going to be a big problem. I wanted to solve this right away, so I took some time to set up the new Unity input system. Setting up the new Unity input system was quite frustrating. The premise of it wasn't hard to understand, but no matter how hard I searched, I couldn't find out how to replace the old onMouseDown method with the new input system. Well, turns out it's not really meant to replace it. At least that's the conclusion I came to. When I realized this, with the help of some googling, I was able to set up my own method to detect where the player is clicking. The input system is detecting when the mouse is clicked, which then triggers my own method, sending a raycast down on the mouse location and returning all game objects in that location. I then check if any of those objects have a custom interface called iClickable, and if they do, I trigger a method in them that does whatever I want to happen when they are clicked. I was honestly expecting that something like this would be pre-made and fully working in the Unity input system, but that didn't seem to be the case. Oh well, after this little detour, at least I am now able to reliably detect when my blocks are clicked. Don't mind the blocks disappearing when I click them. For some reason their depth level changes when I drag them. I'll get that fixed, no problem. Anyway, back to blocks detecting their neighbors. It works great with the additional box colliders. Next, I added the ability to rotate blocks. This was a very simple thing to do. At the same time, I added some numbers to be able to better separate them from each other. Next on my list, I had a very important task. Detecting which spots have an open doorway so you can place a block in there. This was actually quite easy to do. I just used the lasers I made earlier to see if there's an empty spot, and if so, add that spot to a list. After checking all the blocks, I have a list of locations where I can place a block. I also added a quick highlighting feature to visualize the spots. I am simply placing objects with a green box sprite to the open locations. Now that I was able to detect the open spots, I wanted to come up with a way to check if my new room would be able to fit where I want to place it. After all my blocks won't be simple squares. I did some quick googling but couldn't find anything that would apply to my situation. I didn't want to move the actual piece to the location for checking, so I figured maybe I could have an invisible collider that would do the check for me. This turned out to be surprisingly easy. You can just copy the collider path and do the check with the invisible object. The position of the collider is a bit off, but we can fix that. I'll get back to that once I get some doorway functionality going. Finding the three doors and transporting a block to fill the slot was easy enough, but it took me a bit longer to figure out how I could rotate the block and move it so that the two doors are always facing each other. I managed to figure it out though. When I am moving the room, I just need to account for the difference between the cell that the door is in and the cell where the pivot point of the room is in. By doing that and rotating the block, I am able to fit it just right. The outcome is very satisfying. Wait, that's not how it's supposed to work. Okay, I guess the rotation wasn't quite so simple. I was trying to come up with a solution, but I couldn't quite wrap my head around multiple different rotations and how they should be added up together. So my first solution was to brute force the solution by trying every different combination of the variables and trying the ones that produced the right answer in one situation. Turns out none of them worked quite properly. My first idea then was to check the variables before I do the calculation. This was good because I noticed that some of the variables were using the wrong rotation. Always check the variables if something is not working. Okay, now everything should be working. Except that it's not working. This led me to believe that maybe my formula was wrong. I was most likely using too many variables in it, or too few maybe, since otherwise my brute forcing should have been able to produce a viable solution. My code was getting pretty messy, so I did a bit of refactoring and also tested changing the formula. In the end, I was finally able to get it working. I don't know if it was the refactoring or the formula changes or what, and to be honest, I didn't really care. After a half day of trying to get it working properly, I was just happy it worked. Now for the real showdown with the squiggly piece. Looking good. Oh, okay, that's not good. back to the drawing board. It took me quite a bit of time again to think what was the issue and how I would go around solving it. The code was doing many things right, but not everything. At some point I realized what might be the issue. In order to get the doorways, the white little squares, to be next to each other, I was calculating the vector 2 between the pivot point of the room and the middle of the cell where the door exists, but I wasn't accounting for the rotation of the room. So I then made a small addition that the vector 2 between the pivot point and the door cell would also be rotated along with the room. By the way, quick side comment. If you are listening to this and thinking that you don't understand any of it and you can never become a game developer because of that, don't worry. Much of this wouldn't have made sense to me either a few weeks ago, and basically nothing of it would have made sense to me 2 years ago. It's all a learning process and you learn best by doing yourself. So don't be discouraged if something doesn't make sense. Start making games and with time, you will learn everything you need to know. But back to the doorways. I was rotating some vectors and hoping that they would make my doors touch each other. Let's see if that made a difference. Beautiful. Let's try a few other blocks, also for funsies. What about a door ridden squiggly? Oh yeah. I am not yet ready to celebrate, so I made this weird room. I'll call it Swaggly. Let's see how Swaggly fares. Perfect. Okay, I'm ready to believe it works. This really is the best part of coding. I had been banging my head against the keyboard for maybe around 8 hours with this problem, but here we are. I was able to solve it by just sticking with it and trying out things. As much as I feel like celebrating, I want to get more stuff done. So let's combine this room placing code with my code that checks if a room fits somewhere. I wanted to only show me options that actually fit. I had already tested the collision check separately, so I figured this would be an easy task. If only. What was easy was realizing that I needed to apply the rotation to the position adjustment of my invisible collider checker also. But after that, I was having a lot of issues with false positives. I realized that moving my collider was a physics event in Unity, and I would need to wait for the next physics update after moving before I should do the checking. By doing that, I was able to remove some of the false positives, but I was still getting quite a few of them. I then realized my code checked the bounds of the collider, not the collider edges. Changing this removed more of the false positives. But I noticed that the code that checked if the colliders were touching still wasn't exact, and I needed my collision checks to be exact. I found out this was because there is a small offset for touching in Unity physics. I figured I probably won't need to detect the very edges of the rooms to know if they are there, so a practical solution is for me to just make the colliders a little smaller. By doing this, the detection works great and there are no false positives. I just hope I won't get any future need to detect the very edges. If anyone has better ideas, let me know. I know I could store the room coordinates in a list and use that for checking, but I think that might become a limiting factor if I wanted to have some more exotic shapes later on. I also realized that since I need to wait for the physics to update before I check if the room can be placed, I am not able to do it right away in the same method that maps out all the possible placement locations. My one placement checker is also not going to cut it. If I have just one object doing the checking and there's, let's say, 100 different placement options, I would need to wait 100 physics updates. If my math is correct, that's 2 real-life seconds with the default Unity settings before all the locations would be checked. I could adjust how often Unity updates the physics, but I think a more sensible approach would be to just have an army of location checkers. I figured maybe around 100 checkers would be a nice amount to start with. I named them location checker minions to make me feel more authoritative. Now I have 100 minions ready to check locations with each physics update.
I wish only to serve.
So let's say I have 1,000 locations to check. That would be 10 physics updates, so a fifth of a second. That sounds reasonable, as the game mode stutter during that time. The player just won't be able to cycle through the options before that time has passed. I doubt there will ever be 1,000 locations to check at once anyway. But I'll make further adjustments if necessary. All this was quite a bit of work with many different bugs in the code to squash. But the end result is beautiful and so worth it. Let's try it with Swaggly also and change the locations of the blocking rooms a bit. Magnificent. With that out of the way, I figured I would make my colliders a bit more uniform. Not necessary, but I like that they have some common logic behind them instead of just my crude drawings. I also made it so that for the block shape there's a polygon collider, and for detecting the neighbors there is also another polygon collider instead of two box colliders like before. With many shapes, the box colliders just won't do, and I wanted uniformity between the blocks. I also noticed you can easily copy the collider data into a JSON format, so I figured I would store this information in case I want to quickly restore a collider. At this point I decided to expand the UI a bit to provide me some useful information and make the testing a bit easier. I also had to squash a few bugs and do a bit of code refactoring, but luckily nothing major. While doing this, I also realized how cool my location checker minions look if I don't clean them up. Now my basic game mechanic is in a nice playable state. I can create new blocks randomly and have the code correctly give me all the available options where I can place each new block and then set the block down where I choose to. As a nice added bonus, I can also detect the adjacent rooms. This was a good moment for me to clean up the code a bit and add some comments that might later on help me understand what on earth is going on in the code. There are so many different position and rotation variables used that it can get confusing really fast if I don't properly name the variables and comment the calculations. This was my first week working on the game, and I am really happy how much progress I was able to make. Now that I'm doing this full time, I can clearly see the increase in speed. I am sure this being my second game also helps me come up with solutions to problems faster. There's one thing I noticed though that might be comforting to you if you are juggling game dev and another job. I noticed that when I ran into a tough problem, I still needed to spend a lot of time just thinking things through and coming up with potential solutions for how I could solve it. This was time that I didn't really need to spend in front of the computer. Back when I still had an office job, I was using my idle time, like the morning commute or the time spent in useless meetings at the office, to do this sort of thinking. Usually, after the workday, I had many different potential solutions in my mind, ready to be tested when I got back on the computer. This is one great way to make your game dev hours more efficient by doing the thinking work on your downtime hours during the rest of the day. But hey, I think this is a good point to end this devlog. I was aiming to have 2 weeks of progress in one devlog, but this video is already so long that I'll make a separate devlog for the second week. I'll have to see if my progress slows down as I move forward, or if I need to try and put out a devlog every week. Alright, thanks for watching and I'll see you in the next one.